Is anyone as excited as I am? It's silly, right? But so damn cool. Hey, fellow garage fabbers. I'm Aaron with Man Candy's Creations, and welcome to another suspension basics video. If you're just joining, in the first video of this series, we went over the basic movements of a single link bar. If you haven't seen it, stop here and go check it out right now. It's short and it's simple, but incredibly important. So yes, you definitely need to see the first one to understand the sequel. In this episode, we're going to start adding components and build working two-dimensional models of some of the most common rear suspension setups. I've got a feeling this video will be a bit long, so let's stop wasting time. As mentioned in part one, a link bar is used to connect an axle to a vehicle frame in a way that allows for up and down movement. So, let's connect an axle. What we have now is the start of a two-link suspension. Keep in mind we're working with a two-dimensional model, so we are only seeing the left side of this vehicle. So even though we only see one link bar, we must assume there's another link bar on the opposite side. Hence, a two-link suspension. Our two-link setup already has a fatal flaw, and in order to fully understand this flaw and fix it, we need a brief lesson on how an axle behaves under acceleration. It's probably obvious that when we hit the gas, the wheels on the drive axle spin forward, which gives us forward movement, right? What's not as obvious is when we accelerate, our tires are gripping the pavement and resisting the forward spin, which causes the axle housing to try and spin backward. With enough power and enough traction, it's this backward rotation along with a rearward shift and weight that creates wheelies on the drag strip. In the previous episode, we were using a single link bar with pivots on both ends. Our fatal flaw is that the rear pivots. With only two links, there's nothing to resist the twisting motion of the axle tube. We can correct this a few ways. We can use square link bars and connect our axle to them the same way your axle was connected to your leaf springs. Or the preferred method would be a ladder bar setup, where the link bars are somewhat triangular in shape, and the rear of the link connects to the axle in two places, eliminating our unwanted rotation. That's as far as I'm going to go on the construction of a two-link, because I don't recommend it for adjustable suspension. I'll explain in detail why in a future video that I'll call the best link bar setup. As for the two-dimensional model, I just glued the axle to the link bar. Let's cycle the two-link through its travel and map the movement of the axle. It should be no surprise that the axle travels on the same arc as the link bar pivot did in part one. But now I want you to pay attention to the change in the pinion angle. Pinion angle refers to the angle of the input shaft inside the front end of the differential. Pinion angle is extremely important to get right, but for now, let's not worry about why. Let's just build some suspensions and observe how and why the pinion angle changes. With our two-link setup, notice that with our truck fully laid out, the pinion angle points downwards towards the ground. At about half travel, the pinion angle is parallel to the ground, and fully lifted, the pinion angle's upward. Why is that? The reason is pretty simple on this setup. Since our axle is solidly mounted to the link bar, the pinion angle will change in direct proportion to the change in the link bar angle. In other words, if the link bar changes 5 degrees, the pinion angle will change the same amount. Let's make things more interesting by adding another link bar. Seriously, this is where things get really fascinating. Here we have a rear suspension setup that's common in many static height production vehicles. You'll find a similar design in the late model Toyota 4Runner and the Ford Mustang. There are some kits available for mini trucks that utilize a wishbone upper link, which operates in a similar way. With this design, we've got some pretty long lower bars and some shorter upper bars. Let's cycle the suspension and see what we get. The axle travels on an arc not unlike the two-link setup. You'll find this arc is pretty consistent in all of our examples today. Let's check out the pinion angle. If we compress the suspension, the pinion angle points downward, just as it did with the two-link. At half travel, the pinion angle becomes parallel to the ground, just like the two-link. There's a pattern forming here. So obviously, if we fully extend the suspension, the pinion angle will point up, just like the two-link, right? Incorrect. The pinion angle's down again. What? Why? The reason is the uneven length link bars. Remember, in part one, we discussed how shorter link bars follow a tighter arc and therefore have more front to back motion than a longer link bar. Let's single out each of these bars so we can see exactly what's happening. The end of the longer lower bar forms this arc, and the shorter upper bar creates a much tighter arc. When assembled, now we can see what's happening. At half travel, the link bar ends are directly above one another, giving us a pinion angle that's level with the ground. As the suspension compresses, the shorter upper bar, which is following a tighter arc, begins to pull forward sooner than the longer bar does. This causes the top of the axle to pull forward and causes the pinion angle to point downward. When we extend back to half travel, the pinion angle levels out, and when we extend further, the same thing happens as when we compress the suspension. The shorter top bar with the tighter arc again pulls the top of the axle forward. It's so simple, but so satisfying. Let's do another one. Here we have the start of a parallel four-link setup. It's named that because, get this, the upper and lower link bars are parallel to each other. Notice that the bars in this model are not only parallel, but they are also the same length. Let's cycle the suspension and see what happens. First, we see that, again, the axle travels on pretty much the same arc as the previous setup. It moves forward and back about the same amount, but notice the pinion angle. It doesn't matter if the truck is riding low or high, the pinion angle stays exactly the same, even way up here and way down here. The pinion angle doesn't change. Again, our suspensions will never see this extreme, but fun fact, this is the principle behind the movement of the homicide door. So why doesn't the pinion angle change? Because the bars are parallel and the same length. The arc each bar follows is identical, which means the link bar mounts at the top of the axle and the mounts at the bottom are always the same distance away from the front of the vehicle, no matter what position the suspension is in. It's time again to change things up. Let's keep the same length link bars, but this time we'll increase the space between the two front pivot points. Do the thing! Starting with the pinion angle level, we'll compress the suspension. Watch as the pinion angle points upwards. If we extend the suspension, the pinion angle pitches downwards, which is the opposite reaction of the two-link setup. But why? The bars are still the same length, and the arcs are still identical, so what's up? Remember, in order for the angle of the attached components to remain stable, the bars need to not only be the same length, but also must be parallel. What's happening here is though the arcs are the same, the bars are always in different positions within the arc. When compressing the suspension from half travel, notice that the top bar moves toward level with the ground, which pushes the top of the axle rearward, while simultaneously the lower bar is moving away from level, which is pulling the bottom forward, causing the angle to point upward. If we go the other way, the same thing happens, but in reverse. The bottom bar pushes the bottom of the axle back, while the top bar starts to pull, causing the angle to pitch downward. Is anyone as excited as I am? It's silly, right? But so damn cool. I've got one more setup to show you, and it'll end this video with a bang. Let's do two significantly shorter bars, with the top bar being just a little shorter than the bottom one. And let's bring the frame side joints a little closer to one another, so they are not parallel. When we cycle the suspension, notice the angle change on the component end. Compress the suspension, and the component tilts. Bring it back, and a component goes back to straight. This is the grand finale, guys. Take a look at the current model. Okay, now close your eyes. Seriously, close them. Just a blink will do. Okay, open. Can you see the change? No? Well, we just went from rear link bars to front suspension control arms. What? Don't believe me? Let's change this mystery component to a front spindle and wheel. Bam! I've been intentionally replacing specific components with generic ones for this reason. Rear suspension is easier to understand, but the rules apply to front suspension too. Now, let's air this thing out again. Psst! What used to be a change in pinion angle is now a change in camber. Let's review the cause once more. With the lower control arm level with the ground, as it generally should be at ride height, the shorter upper control arm is tilted up slightly. As we compress the suspension, the shorter control arm pulls the top of the wheel in faster than the longer control arm, causing an increase in negative camber. Don't let this video put a limit on what you can use link bars on. We're focusing on suspensions, but the uses are endless. There are tons of things already in existence that use these principles. This lamp shares a design with a parallel forelink. Custom hood hinges use some of these principles, and so does the homicide door. Don't be afraid to get creative and experiment with some push pins and cardboard. All right, everybody, I feel this video may have overstayed its welcome. If you appreciate the info, please hit the thumbs up button. And if you want to see more, consider subscribing as well. This video is going to be a memorable one for me because it will go live about the same time GarageFab crosses the 1,000 subscriber mark. I appreciate every one of you. Thank you. In the next one, we're going to briefly discuss unique link bar shapes, and we're going to move on from 2D models and dip our toes into the third dimension with a mini truck frame that I'm building just for this channel. Thank you again, everyone. And until the next one, my friends, keep moving forward.